It spans 30 years, and he starts as a man who's kind of a bit more of a voyeur of his life than not. And he's a guy who's containing a lot of vitality and energy that he releases as the movie goes on. But it's a story of a guy who becomes himself in the process of the story, and that's through different marriages, and it's through screwing things up horrendously all the time.
Blair, I'd like to speak with my wife.
Oh, Barney, it's 3 o'clock in the morning.
Put my wife on the phone.
She's not your wife, and I'm not waking her.
Well, then just ask her what she wants me to do with all these nude photos I have of her. Come to think of it, you actually might want them, if only to see what Miriam looked like in her prime.
I first read Barney's version when Mordecai Richter sent me the manuscript. And there are various reasons why I decided that I was going to make this movie. First, because it's a magnificent novel. The politically incorrect and irreverent tone of this book speak to my heart. This is a story of a life fully lived by a man who makes countless mistakes, but whose heart is in the right place. Though not everyone knows that until the end.
Daddy, Blair had a heart attack last night.
Really?
Yes, really.
How bad?
Minor. He thought it was indigestion.
What?
Dad, it's still a heart attack.
Yeah, that's true. You know, the long-term effects of these things don't often show up until later. Impotence is still on the table.
Are you not at all concerned that you might have caused this?
Why would I be?
Mom told me about the phone call last night. The one that woke Blair up at 3:30 in the morning. Dad.
Listen, sweetheart, I gotta call you back. I'm on the elevator.
You better. And Michael. He's been trying to reach you too.
I will.
It's a story of a man's life who basically has only one enemy, and that is himself. He is able to reach out and try to achieve his full potential, but then when wrestling with the demons that come with such potential, he somehow falls prey to the monster, and the monster is him. And that's a quote from the book, that he found the monster, and the monster was me, he says.
I mean, it's one of those characters, and part of it is because of the aging, but you sort of get to do everything as this guy. He's conflicted, but he's very blunt, and he's nasty, but he's sweet. He's a very romantic guy in a lot of ways, and impulsive.
Actually, I'm getting married.
What?
I say I'm getting married.
To who?
To me. Prince Charming Bomb here knocked me up by way of a magical 30 seconds of friction.
Where the hell have you been?
Who?
You didn't come home last night.
Who remembers? Has he told you what he's doing now?
No.
Exporting olive oil to some guy Jaime back in Montreal? It's like a bad Jewish sitcom.
You know, someone's got to make a living.
Barney couldn't be your conventional leading man. Otherwise, the fact that he has these three magnificent wives, that all these women fall for Barney Panofsky, wouldn't really mean much if he looked like Brad Pitt. So we needed an actor who did not have movie star looks, but who had tremendous charisma and charm and wit, and who, while being gruff, and gruff is very important that Barney be gruff, his inner lovability would play through his eyes. This is something that Paul has in spades. Whether it's a woman, or whether it's in friendship, or whether it's in business, this is a man who's got to get what he wants by being really clever, by cutting corners, by outmaneuvering others, by outsmarting others.
I play Barney's first wife, and it takes place in the early 70s, which is, explains a lot about all this.
Barney Panofsky.
Barney Panofsky.
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 Clara Chernofsky.
No. Oh, si chiama Clara Chambers.
I was married to a Russian gangster for 5 days. I ran away on the honeymoon. I just never bothered to do the paperwork to change the name back.
Oh, did you ever think to mention this?
Don't worry. You're still getting yourself a true blue shiksa.
The first thing I did to prepare for the role of Clara, obviously, was I read the book cover to cover. And then I started to get into learning about mental illness. Clara doesn't get diagnosed by Mordecai, and she doesn't get diagnosed in our movie with any particular, like, nomenclature, but she certainly is ill in some way and emotionally unstable. And I just really wanted to do that justice. And once I showed up on set, she was sort of fully formed in that way.
So throughout the entire second year of my master's degree, I have a master's degree, I had this reoccurring dream where I'm 16 again and I'm standing in Ruben's butcher shop in St. Viateur, and I have this long pigtail and it has a ribbon in it, which my Aunt Sarah bought back from Saks in New York City. And did you know Ruben? He was such a card. When I was 10, he would always come around from behind the counter and he would go, "How come a beauty like you isn't married yet?" And I was only 10.
She's a product of what her parents wanted her to be. She's a product of the period, of all of the social tenets of the time, of everything she was told she was meant to be, she is. And I think when Barney doesn't want to play along with those rules, it upsets the natural course of her trajectory in life.
Can I be clear on something? You didn't get divorced on my account, did you?
Of course I did.
You hardly know me.
Miriam's Barney's third wife, and I just think that they share the most wonderful love story. It's the kind of love story that we'd kind of all like to have in our sort of fantasy lives. I mean, their meeting is so ludicrous and so romantic, the fact that he runs out of his own wedding to chase her onto a train. The characters are also sort of feeling like they're caught up in this wonderful, giddy fiction, and then that materializes into a very, very true, very, very real marriage and lifelong love affair. And I think Miriam is the love of Barney's life and Barney is the love of Miriam's life.
I'm just gonna keep talking here because I'm afraid that if I stop, there's gonna be a pause or a break and you're gonna say it's getting late or I should get going. And I'm not ready for that to happen. I don't want that to happen. Ever.
There it was. The pause.
Yeah.
I'm still here.
I believe in Paul totally as Barney. I believe in us as Barney and Miriam, and I just adore him. Paul's just endlessly inventive and fun to work with, and you know, everything that happens seems to happen in real time. We think of things beforehand, but so much is allowed to happen in the moment, which is great.
I'm helped out a lot by the makeup, basically. I mean, it's the cue for me what era I'm supposed to be in. Seriously, I mean, it would be hard if I wasn't wearing the makeup to let me know where I'm supposed to go. And a lot of it's up to me to try to be the right age and things like that. But it's not as hard as you would think, and it's fun.
Jesus Christ, Boogie, this is brilliant. When are they publishing it? No, they're not. Why not? I'm never giving it to that ridiculous editor. Okay, what about the advance that they paid you?
I wrote him another one.
You're kidding. Which?
I think everybody knows what a great actor he is, and we just became fast friends and sort of developed a natural rapport, which helps a ton when you got to do these chemistry scenes. And he's amazing, and he's always very supportive and open and genuinely interested in your ideas about a scene. And
you know, I was thinking about something. Maybe you should move in with us.
The kids are gone, we got a lot of space. What do you say?
Thanks, but no thanks.
I just don't like the idea of you being alone, that's all.
I'm not alone. You see that? Jacob Stern, no wife. That's alone. I'm gonna be right here near your mother. When you get to be my age, you'll see what a comfort that is.
The most important thing was keeping in the spirit of the book and keeping loyal to it. We went over it line by line, and Robert was always really the defender of the tone of it, because he was an old friend of Mordecai's, and doing this book properly was a huge thing for him.
It's about the joys of being alive, and it's about compassion, and translating that through this film is our objective, and Mordecai Richler gave us a splendid, stupendous map to guide us in translating all those emotions.